I'd like to thank everyone for joining today's event about the ABCs of fund finance. I'm Michael Peterson. I'm a managing director in Citco Bank's capital markets business. I'll give a brief introduction of myself and my other colleague Shiraz, and then I'll turn it over to Matt Kerfoot from Dechert. Most of you may know Citco. We're the world's largest private alternative asset administrator. We are also both a lender to our bank and an advisor to our clients as well, with a variety of services around fund finance, and LP finance, and trading. I'd like to thank Matt Kerfoot from Dechert and also Shiraz Allidina from ourselves.
Thank you, Michael. Just a quick plug for our group. I'm a partner in the financial services and global finance groups here at Dechert in New York. Global finance has about 130 lawyers in New York, London, and some other offices around the world. I focus on fund finance, and we're proud of the practice. We were recognized again by Private Debt Investors Law Firm of the Year. We work on sublines and asset-based facilities. It's a regular part of the practice, the fundamental aspect of the practice. And much of what we will talk about today are the issues and considerations that have come up over the past year or so as we've been structuring these facilities. So with that, I think I'll turn it back to Michael to kick us off.
Okay, so just a quick high-level overview of the market. Obviously, many of you are participants in the alternative fund market, but this is a good place to start, frankly, for a good discussion. So I think most of you have understood for quite some time that the private capital funds has grown quite substantially over the past number of years. Supposedly, I think we're a little over $4.6 trillion, actually, or at least that's projections for year-end. Roughly speaking, you know, let's talk about what a private capital fund is, because many people just associate it with your traditional private equity closed-end structure. When we say private capital as it relates to a subscription line facility, you're talking about any closed-end structure. So you could be a real estate fund, a true private equity fund. You could be a real assets fund, infrastructure, or potentially a credit fund. Again, it's all around the closed-end structure with no kind of redemption type cycles. In this marketplace, you know, you've seen Q3 to today, we've seen about $338 billion raised. That's above the $286 billion that was raised last year at this time. 80% of the funds in market have beat their targets. It looks like 2017 will be an all-time record, potentially surpassing 2007. And specifically, one note of growth in the market that you can't miss is actually in the debt fund space. So whether that is your traditional kind of BDC, private BDCs, middle market lending funds, or real estate lending funds, that's been quite an area of growth across the world, both in the U.S. and Europe specifically.
Yeah, I would just add that what we're seeing, at least in the private debt side, is these private debt funds acting as credit intermediators. So they stand between commercial banks that previously may have faced middle market borrowers, small businesses, where commercial banks have stepped away from that space, or there's been consolidation with regional banks. So these private debt funds are standing in the middle between the commercial banks and these borrowers, and these private debt funds will borrow at LIBOR plus 2, 3, 4. And then they'll extend that credit on a portfolio basis at a weighted average yield of sometimes 8, 9, 10%. And there's been a lot of that, at least in the United States, is driving the growth of the private debt space. And so a lot of what we've been focusing on here at Dechert is really that part of the market where representing banks lending to private debt funds or representing private debt funds taking on leverage from banks. But a lot of that is capital, at least debt capital that's being raised and then allocated throughout, at least in the U.S., throughout the middle market and the small business space.
Sure. One comment I'll add to it, I think we'll get to it a little bit more in some of the slides, is specific in the private debt fund space. You see them using both subscription lines and also, you know, traditionally you'd say warehouse for securitization, but in this case it's not. It's more of a rediscount facility. But the idea is because the fund obviously wants to retain the assets for the yield returns, but you'll see them using both. And there's a mix of what lenders are good at, different types of loans in terms of leveraging the funds, and some guys who are not. But there's some nuances there, and we'll go through that a little bit later. So fundamentally, you know, what is a subscription facility? Generally speaking, it's a short-term secured credit facility that the GP uses to manage day-to-day expenses, working capital, deal expenses, you name it. It's available, again, going back to my point, what Matt was saying a minute ago, it's available to all types, again, of closed-end fund managers who have, you know, committed LPs to the structure. It's not just for a private equity fund or just for an infrastructure fund. It's available to everyone, and they'll use it for a variety of kind of working capital needs versus calling on the limited partners who've committed to the fund.
I would just add that sublines have been in the news quite a bit lately, and there's been quite a bit of attention from LPs and advisors to LPs on the terms and conditions of sublines. But it's important to remember that a subscription line is not leverage in the traditional sense. That is, the fund, if it's a PE fund or a credit fund, the fund is not able to use the line to invest in a greater amount of assets or a larger amount of assets than it has in terms of its equity capital. It really, as Michael said, is just intended to match cash flows. But in some cases, and we'll get into this, there can be some IRR effects as a result of accelerating cash flows or accelerating distributions to LPs and payment of management fees. But I think it's important to just remember that it's not a traditional leverage facility where there's debt capital being added to equity capital and an increased amount of capital being used to purchase portfolio assets. So the subline you know, nowadays is secured primarily by the capital commitments to the fund. You know, traditionally, years and years ago, when you saw this commonly with real estate funds and private equity funds, you know, often those lines were not secured at all. They were not committed. They're really like liquidity, you know, unsecured liquidity or redemption facilities. Now, I would say the market clearly has evolved into a secured line with longer maturities. We'll get to that separately. But it while it's not intended to be used as structural leverage, it has some of the flavor or the sense of structural leverage. The subline, as I mentioned, is secured by the capital commitments. If there were to be a default, the bank basically can step into the shoes of the general partner to call capital. And we'll talk a little bit more about termination and remedies, but that is the idea. And then there's typically a deposit account that's also leaned up and subject to a DACA, to a deposit account control agreement. And those accounts obviously are used to hold the capital contributions. I will say it's interesting. I think it's interesting. In this market, when we're representing a fund, we may get, you know, form subline credit documents from the bank, and I think more often than not, the collateral package will include the portfolio assets. It's almost as if now that the collateral package is expected to include the portfolio assets. So it's almost one of the initial comments that we'll provide when we're representing the fund, or at least have a discussion with the fund as to whether or not portfolio assets are going to be included. I would say typically, though, we push back on that. There are certain hybrid arrangements and certain other circumstances where portfolio assets will be leaned up. But as a general matter, it's typically the case that the collateral is just the capital commitments. We'll talk a little bit also about the scope of the right for the GP to exercise the ability to call capital. There sometimes can be in the collateral package other GP contractual rights that the GP may have with respect to limited partners. But ideally, you know, from the fund side, we try to circumscribe the collateral package to just these capital commitments, the related contractual rights to call the capital, and then the deposit accounts that hold the capital contributions.
So the main use of these facilities, or the main benefit that they afford, is timing and flexibility. So for example, we've typically seen same-day funding for the facilities, or at worst, two-day funding whereas typically LP agreements require 1 to 2 weeks of notice before the LPs fund. What this does is allows the fund to use the bridge or the subscription line to bridge an investment and then subsequently call capital from the LPs. Now, not only does it provide a timing advantage, it also resolves some of the uncertainty surrounding the deal process. So let me give you an example. So if you've got a deal that's closing in 2 weeks and you elect to call money from your LPs, lo and behold, when you get to the closing table, something occurs, be it the seller or a third party or something in documentation, and you find that the deal has been delayed, the closing has been delayed for weeks or potentially months. We've all been in that situation. Now, if you've called capital from the LPs, that money sits on the balance sheet of the fund and is a drag on returns. If you've used a subscription facility, it's no harm, no foul. You can just return the capital to the lender. These are revolving credit facilities, and you can draw that money when the deal is set to close. So that allows the fund a little bit more flexibility with regard to managing the uncertainty surrounding the deal process. Another thing that we've seen, albeit less frequent, is that people have used these facilities as bridge financing prior to placement of debt at the investment level. So as we all know, banks in this environment take their time to get their ducks in a row, and sometimes deal urgency requires a quick close. So you can use these facilities as your primary leverage, and later when the banks are ready to fund at the investment level, those proceeds can be used to pay back the facilities. And in addition to the flexibility with regard to timing, we find that our clients benefit from the negotiating leverage that a subscription line affords when negotiating with banks. So the banks are aware that the fund has that subscription line, and therefore they can't kind of put the screws on during negotiations. So we find that that's a pretty good benefit for funds. Next slide, please.
Shiraz, I'd add one comment to that. Actually, I've seen, Matt, I don't know what you've seen about this, but specifically with our own client bases and some loans that we've done recently, we've actually seen, not on the traditional private equity portfolio purchaser of an asset of an operating company, but more on the debt side, funds who are either middle market lenders or real estate lenders, we've seen them actually opt for kind of same day funding to the extent it's available, because in some cases they're either funding multiple loans in a given day at the underlying level, or in some cases they're actually purchasing portfolios of loans, and the timing is sometimes out of their control for a little bit and they're looking for quick close. So we've seen an increased need for people who are looking for same day or next day funding out of the credit funds specifically.
Yeah, we've seen something similar. It's interesting how traditionally these lines were used by real estate funds and then private equity funds. But as credit funds can, I guess, use these more commonly, that asset class and the needs of the fund in managing that asset class has driven a lot of the changes that we're seeing in subscription lines. So as Michael was saying, there might be need for quick execution because it's a loan, right? It's not a portfolio company that's being acquired, and there has to be a relatively quick decision made. So we will also see same day. I think we put 12 hours in the slide. It could actually be less than 12 hours to draw down on that line, and provided that the underlying asset is, you don't necessarily have to have a diligence, but provided it fits within a matrix of eligible collateral, I think banks, at least we've seen the banks that we've represented, have been willing to lend against that or prepared to advance funds on the same day basis.
I'd also add one additional comment, which is we have clients who are borrowers, actually, who are global institutions in a sense. They operate on a massive scale in multiple jurisdictions, countries, and they could have deal teams in Asia. The fund could be a Cayman fund, and the deal teams could be in Asia, Europe, and the U.S. In the Asian team, they may submit it into their investment committee to pull the money. When it gets to us, you're partially, their day is over, but they still want us to fund before the end of our day. So lenders being able to be flexible to deal with a global fund mandate is also a part of this, too. There are very different there are different banks and lenders in the space and how they operate, but as our fund clients get more complex, you notice that the demands get complex as well.
Great. So the other real benefit is that this allows people to consolidate kind of multiple capital calls, and some of the larger LPs, they get numerous capital calls per week, both from a fund perspective and an LP perspective, it's beneficial to have what we see from our clients is typically one capital call per quarter, and that just is much more operationally efficient. And also the fact that everyone knows when that capital call is slated to occur makes things just much more predictable from both the fund's perspective and the LP's perspective.
With private credit funds, I think, as Michael was just saying, we're seeing more and more private credit funds use and rely on sublines. And in those funds, those tickets in the portfolio are obviously much smaller or can be much smaller than an entire company. So we were working with a private credit fund just yesterday, and the CFO on the call when we were structuring the subline said that the LPs were actually getting irritated. There's so many calls. This is just for one fund. There's so many calls just for this one, for each of those relatively small tickets, that the LPs were suggesting that something needs to be done, which is why we were on a phone call structuring a subline, but something needs to be done to smooth out these calls and to make them less frequent. But that's what we see more commonly with the private debt funds, given the relatively smaller sizes of the assets in those portfolios.
And to that point, I'm going to pause for 1 second. And Matt, you referred to this a little bit earlier about investors' thoughts around the use of sublines. We actually hosted an event recently with the top 27 endowments, U.S. educational endowments, and their comments about use of leverage. To your point, it's not leverage at the fund for the sake of it to go out and extend and do more deals. It's working capital. You need to understand if you put yourself in the position of many of these LPs, they're not staffed appropriately. We have some LP clients who get 350 calls in a given day.
350?
Yes. Because they're an LP. So think about they have over a couple of hundred individual PE or real estate or et cetera, right? So when they get these calls, they're not operationally staffed to actually comply with it, read it, check the docs, make sure that they actually have the unfunded capital still out there. They're capable of paying. They're not capable of processing. So the use of these facilities, you know, again, prudently, we found in serving our own client base, obviously there's some comments from ILPA and others about this recently, but they're okay with it for the sake of operational efficiency.
All right, next slide, Shiraz.
Yes. So as this shows, is and just echoing your comments, to pay ancillary, smaller expenses, rather than drawing from the LPs, these facilities can be very useful to do things like collateralizing, currency margin requirements, or paying fees or taxes. What this also does is allows the fund to more efficiently use their capital. They don't have to hold as much cash on the balance sheet or any cash for that matter, just by virtue of having the liquidity from the facility. Next slide.
Before we go to the next slide, though, it's interesting that, as I mentioned at the start of the webinar, the line is not used for leveraging a portfolio, but it certainly can affect the timing of the cash flows. And there's been a lot of talk about the effect that sublines can have on the IRR. So obviously when the fees or the management fees are not paid out of the portfolio, but they're paid through the subline, that can have a substantially beneficial impact on the IRR. If the fees are taken out of the actual portfolio at a later stage in the life of the fund, that could certainly help the IRR. And there are a number of questions that investors have had about, you know, whether the IRR should be reported, you know, net of the subline or exclusive of the subline. ILPA and some others, as Michael had mentioned, have expressed those concerns. One point on the collateralization, a number of these funds will have issues with cash management. That's one of the reasons why we have the subline in the first place. And in the past, foreign exchange hedging for different share classes or for different non-USD assets in the portfolio, often those foreign exchange hedging arrangements were not subject to any collateral requirements. The derivatives counterparty would just take the risk on the portfolio, or would just take a lien on the portfolio, but would not worry about day-to-day margin calls. The new derivatives rules do require T+1 collateralization. So one of the uses of the proceeds in these sublines is often to allow the fund to satisfy that T+1 derivatives margin requirement.
So as Matt just mentioned, you know, just by virtue of the math, the IRR, the reported IRR of the fund increases. in our experience, at least in my experience, and guys, jump in if you disagree, I haven't seen any funds use these facilities primarily to increase IRR. They use the facilities for the aforementioned reasons, the operational efficiency, the timing and uncertainty resolution, and to fund ancillary expenses and better optimize cash balances. The one exception I would mention is our credit funds that Matt alluded to earlier. Credit funds whose mandate involves using leverage in order to lend and who disclose in both their private placement memoranda and their LP agreements that they're using leverage, they will often use these facilities as quasi-permanent leverage. When I say quasi-permanent, is at the beginning of the investment period, they use these facilities to close on loans. Subsequently, as they draw capital, they repay these facilities and refill their lending capacity with NAV or asset-based loans, which we'll get to in a little bit. But that's how credit funds tend to structure their portfolios, and they find that these types of credit facilities are very cost-efficient and very operationally efficient for their needs. The other point I wanted to make on this slide is, and I think this is underappreciated by a large number of commentators, is that the greater certainty with regard to timing of impending contributions inures to the benefit of the limited partners. What I mean is, you know, they know when those impending contributions are going to occur. For that reason, they can better optimize their cash balances, their liquidity securities balances. That's a clear economic benefit that they receive from these facilities. And we've heard comments from our own clients who are limited partners who have mentioned this to us.
Yeah, I would say it's interesting. Both LPs and GPs, I think, are aligned in the sense that an increased reported IRR, it seems to benefit both parties, GPs for attracting investors and LPs when reporting to their investment committees. You hear the term J-curve compression all the time now with the use of sublines. And I would agree with Shiraz, it's not the purpose. I don't think it's the purpose. It's just that tends to be the effect of the use of the subline. All right, so we're going to get into some of the more important structuring issues that we've come across, at least here at Dechert. I'll let Michael and Shiraz speak for themselves. Some of the issues that we've been wrestling with sublines, a lot of these issues are basically an attempt to achieve a balance between what the GP needs and then what the LP, you know, the institutional LP community is demanding. So ILPA and some others have expressed concerns about when the GP can earn the incentive fee, whether the terms and conditions of the line can affect other LPs. We'll talk about how the collateral package will include certain limited partners, but exclude other limited partners, and there's some issues as to whether or not a default under the subline may actually result in any adverse effects on the excluded limited partners. We'll talk a little bit about the impact on, with respect to UBTI, on tax-sensitive investors. I would say, before we get into the substance of this, as a general matter, when we're representing the funds, we have seen, both from the lender and from the LPs, quite a bit of increased diligence. Now, obviously, on the lender side, the lender is lending against limited partnership balance sheets, effectively whether these LPs can fund their commitments. Part of that, an important part of that, is the diligence on whether the LP has certain abilities to delay funding the call, whether there's certain side letter provisions that may affect the ability of the GP to call the collateral, whether the LP itself, depending on what type of institution it is, may have some ability to avoid having to fund a call. And as a result, there's quite a bit of diligence that the banks appropriately are going through with respect to LPs. And similarly, on the LP side, Probably, I would say more recently, there's been an extensive amount of diligence from the more sophisticated institutional LPs on what exactly are the terms and conditions of the subline. I think in many cases, if not most cases, the more sophisticated LPs will actually send through some type of survey or set of questions to the GP when the GP is putting one of these lines in place, and will ask questions as to what are the use of proceeds, whether it will have, whether the fund is going to be using it to pay management fees, to accelerate distributions, all sorts of things like that. It's that confluence of issues that we generally are wrestling with when we're putting these sublines in place and structuring and negotiating them. And we'll, in the next set of slides, we're going to try to run through those primary issues that we're dealing with when doing that.
A couple of quick comments in the interest of time, I'll make them quick. To your point, I think you covered the aspect from a lender pretty well. I will say, since we're both a lender and advisor and an asset servicer, we kind of see all sides of this. From our LP clients, one thing, you mentioned ILPA and a few others that came up recently, what the LPs have been asking us to do are track the lenders who are lending in the space to their clients, compared across vintage deals, similar peer sets, what the cost of capital are, commitment fees, LPV of the facility, total use of leverage across the funds. And they're, at this point, I'd say many of the LPs are just trying to understand who's using these facilities, what for, and then fees, returns, net and gross of fees. So I think many of the LPs are just in a listen and learn stage, more or less, but there is a lot of due diligence going on behind the scenes on the LP side as well. Okay, talking about structuring a little bit, as Matt alluded to a little bit earlier, you have different types of LPs. You have the institutional versus the quote-unquote family office, or I change high net worth to both ultra high net worth and high net worth, and they all have very different meanings to the lenders. Many lenders, to be honest, won't touch the high net worth, and frankly only touch the ultra high net worth to an extent that it's a extremely well-known family office with a very provable total asset base. Some of the LPs, again, you may exclude them based on a variety of factors. One of them may be sovereign immunity. Some entities have what's called sovereign immunity, which means you cannot necessarily enforce rights against them. How most lenders get around that, some have such a track record with them that they can just deal with it. Others will wait for 20-30% of the capital to be funded by that LP before they advance against them. So there's different ways you can address the sovereign immunity issues. Due diligence issues with LPs. Again, most banks like ourselves and some of the others who've been in this space for a very long time know most of the major LPs globally and have our own internal databases and way of rating the LPs. Others may not, and they may ask for a lot of upfront due diligence on the LPs themselves, which can be timely and a little bit intrusive to both the LPs and the GP, and that tends to be something that, people, obviously the GPs don't want to do these days. Rated institutions versus unrated versus the high net worth, what you'll generally see that do or happen amongst the lender bases is you kind of have a matrix, right, which will be in a matrix of advance rates for highly rated institutions versus kind of your middle tier pension plans, we call it 0 to 5 billion in assets or so that don't necessarily carry a rating. We also look at, for example, certain sub pension plans per se, where let's say the Turnpike Authority of a state, where you look at the credit collateral, you look at the credit quality of that institution first. If it doesn't make sense, you go back up to the parent, being the state entity, and that's how we get some of the ratings, and we can figure out how you advance against that collateral. So there's a mix of ways you handle this, but generally speaking, your family office and your high net worth are out of favor because it's very hard to model and understand how they perform. But through the cycle, generally speaking, your institutions have performed very well. This business has a very low default factor historically, and it's been a fantastic business for the banks on a relationship basis. But each deal is different. Therefore, when the lender looks at your LPs, we'll look at the fund itself, the documents, the ability of LPs that Matt mentioned about whether they can delay funding, et cetera, sovereign immunities before we actually price this.
And related to that, once the bank has a portfolio of LPs that it's comfortable with, obviously from the bank's perspective, that would be a static portfolio of limited partners. as a practical matter, of course, limited partners from time to time are looking to transfer their positions. And, you know, separate apart from this, there's a rather robust liquid secondary market these days. The way that sublines work, understandably, is that the LPs, or at least a certain percentage of the LPs, actually cannot transfer their interests because, as Michael had said, there's an extensive amount of diligence done on that initial portfolio of limited partners, and if suddenly 20% or 25% of the LPs can transfer their interests and bring new and have new LPs join the fund, then that's going to present issues from the bank, and it's suddenly lending against a certain LPs that haven't been diligent. So what is included in nearly every subline is a negative covenant that effectively limits the ability of the GP to consent to transfer to LP transfers of more than X percent. And we've seen that as low as 5%. It can be higher, but we've seen as low as 5%. That can be an issue, obviously, for limited partners who are thinking, you know, prior to the use of the subline, the GP would certainly be willing to provide that consent. In some circumstances, though, now the GP is subject to a covenant. So there are some ways that we have tried to structure around that. In some cases, obviously, this should only apply to included LPs. In many form documents, at least, the limits on the transferability will apply to all LPs, but we've tried to limit, when we're representing funds, to limit this to included LPs. Also, one thing that I think is relatively new is if the LP is transferring to a new LP that fits within certain agreed upon criteria in terms of the size of the balance sheet, whether it's rated, whether it's a sovereign entity or not, that has been somewhat helpful in trying to structure around this covenant that we've seen subline documentation. The scope of the recourse, something I alluded to earlier, obviously from the bank side, we try to get the scope of the recourse as broad as possible. So we would like to basically subrogate to the GP and call the capital that we need to call and exercise other rights that we may have in the LPA against the limited partners. The fund obviously would prefer to limit the scope of that right. Some of the related issues, though, arise. What happens if the subline defaults and an LP fails to fund? It would not be the first time that there could be a strategic default by an LP. The question then is, what rights does the GP have that the lender would exercise against other LPs? What rights may the lender have against other assets possibly held by the fund? It really depends on the structure. As I mentioned at the bottom of the bottom of the slide, we have done a number of facilities where there is this backup lien on portfolio companies. And it's almost like we have a waterfall where if there is a default, first the first step is to call the capital from the LPs and potentially exercise all the rights that the GP has against the LPs, and then potentially to look to the assets that are held by the fund. I think that's relatively rare, but it's certainly something that we have seen I've seen this year. So, just quickly on unrelated business taxable income, no one on this call is a lawyer, a tax lawyer, but we did want to mention it because it comes up in virtually every type of LP question that we get on sublines. I would say traditionally years ago that when these lines were unsecured and they were callable, there might be a 90-day period when a loan would be outstanding, and so that relatively short period of time limits the stress on the UBTI analysis. Now, some of these lines are drawn down for much longer periods of time, including up to a year. That longer-term outstanding debt obviously stresses the UBTI analysis. So, on the fund side, we may wish to have the ability to have cleanup calls or ensure that the maturity dates aren't extended to the point where tax-sensitive LPs may be adversely affected by the longer outstandings on the line. There are also some structural considerations or solutions. So, in certain circumstances, the subline actually can be extended to a blocker entity that would be held below the fund. That blocker entity could be a corporate, could be a 40 Act entity, could be a REIT. That helps to block or limit the exposure on the UBTI, and then the fund itself can provide a guarantee to the blocker, and that effectively gets to the same place that the lender was in when it was lending against the LP interest at the fund level. But it's a topic that gets a lot of attention. I think there's a lot of thinking right now that's going into how to structure and address these UBTI issues.
In terms of the types of facilities, you generally have two different flavors at a high level, a committed and uncommitted facility. Uncommitted we used to see this more often. It's crept back a little bit, but I don't know that it's going to take off per se. In the sense where it's uncommitted, where you're not paying the upfront fees, you reduce some of the costs, and you're hoping the lender will be there when you need to borrow, and it is truly for a short-term basis. Most loans we see today are really your traditional kind of committed facility where it'll be outstanding either for anywhere from 12 months to the entire investment period, depending on the fund. Again, the specific strategy demands what they want to use it for. And again, how often they draw, how long they keep it outstanding, it varies widely depending on what type of fund it is, be it true PE, credit, otherwise. The single LP subscription lines, I see this a lot in the managed account space for large institutional LPs. It varies depending on your point of view. Some lenders are okay with this if it's a rated LP backing it. They can take the collateral. Others cannot because it's just, so to speak, single point of failure. So it depends on the bank you're dealing with, and it really much depends on the LP and the conditions of the account itself.
Okay, one more point on sublines before we transition to asset-based facilities. I spoke earlier on termination and remedies, and it's really just a spectrum as we see it. So ideally, the lender would have the remedy of exercising the ability just to call the capital. On the other side of that spectrum is the ability to exercise any rights that the GP may have under the LPA. The LPs, when we talk to the LPs, they're generally concerned about the ability of the lender to step into the shoes of the GP and just exercise discretion over management decisions. And it's that tension that we focus on when we're structuring the terminations and remedies. As I mentioned on the prior slide, we are seeing some facilities that are kind of like hybrid facilities. They're hybrids of sublines and then asset-based facilities that we'll talk about next. And even if it's not a formal hybrid structure that transitions from a subline to an asset-based line, the subline can have some of the features of the asset-based line. And when the bank exercises remedies, may be able to exercise remedies against the portfolio assets. So I think that is a good point on which to transition to what we're seeing in the asset-based facility space.
So an asset-based facility, what is it? Simply, it is a loan secured by a subset of the assets of the fund. Now, typically, it's held in a drop-down entity that is wholly owned by the fund, and it's typically secured by either a pledge of equity in that entity or a lien on that entity's assets. That entity's bankruptcy or moat, and there is occasionally credit support that is provided by the fund. That's not always the case. Matt, if you want to jump in on the credit support.
Yeah, in a couple of slides, we'll go through a diagram. But often in these deals, the collateral will be ring-fenced in an SPV, which we'll also talk about. And That's effectively the collateral package for the bank, but in many cases there can be a parent guarantee, which raises a number of other issues when the borrower really is just trying to ring fence a specific subset of its assets for a particular financing.
So what? How are these typically used? So what we found is that the primary users, or one of the largest users, are the credit funds that we've discussed previously, who are leveraged lenders and whose central business plan involves leveraging their loan assets. So they use these facilities to leverage their assets in order to achieve their returns. Sometimes these lenders have a CLO or other securitization exit where they refinance the asset-based loan using that securitization, but often they can just hold those to maturity on the loans themselves. We also from time to time see fund-to-funds or other hedge fund investors use these facilities. So Citco, in fact, has a lending unit that lends to investors and hedge funds secured by those hedge fund investments. And our clients use these facilities to bridge the subscriptions and redemptions to their underlying funds when they're rebalancing their portfolios. So that's often of benefit to them because there's typically a gap between the time you redeem from one fund and are required to subscribe to another. Another way we've seen these used is by purchasers of LP interests on the secondary market. So those purchasers use asset-based facilities or NAV loans to help finance those transactions. Or alternatively, by potential sellers of LP interests who are seeking to get liquidity on their investments, they use these types of financings as an alternative to selling their LP interests. Lastly, we see some funds use these facilities once they've gone past their investment period as a means to do follow-on investments or protective advances for their current portfolios. So after their investment period's done, they may have an issue with regard to their current portfolio, or they may want to make a follow-on investment in the fund, so they can use the additional leverage from these facilities to make those investments.
One thing, Shiraz, I would add briefly is in the terms of the credit funds, the high yield or kind of lending funds, you should note that the use of the subscription line and back with the asset-based facility is always fully disclosed inside the LPA, and the GP is very cognizant of the fact of what they're doing, and it's discussed with the LPs that this intentionally is a leverage product versus, you know, other funds who are just using a subscription line just to help run daily cash management points.
That's right.
This is the picture that I promised. This is the fund at the top level. The fund is running a portfolio of, you know, usually, I think more often we're seeing private credit. The fund will want to hive off a portion of that portfolio. So the fund, in many cases, is distributing to its investors, you know, maybe periodic interest payments or distributions, I should say, or dividends. Those dividends are distributed off of a leveraged portfolio. So the fund will take a certain part of its portfolio and place that in an SPV in exchange for the equity in the SPV. Now that specific type of portfolio, and you know the parameters around the portfolio criteria that we'll get into, that can be developed for a specific lender. So there might be some lenders that are comfortable with broadly syndicated loans, more so than, you know, bilateral bank debt. And so the fund, when structuring a deal for a particular lender, a more conservative lender that wants to lend only against BSL or primarily against BSL, can set up an SPV and include that particular portfolio in that SPV. And obviously the fund then can take another part of its portfolio, one perhaps that's primarily bank debt, that another lender may be more comfortable with, and obviously for a higher spread, place that into another SPV and take on debt from that other lender. But this structure allows the fund to identify certain portions of its portfolio, find the appropriate balance sheet or lender to lend against it, and then also provides the lender with some certainty that if there were to be a default in SPV2, that would not result in a default to an SPV 1. Or if there's a default at the fund level, that would not affect the SPV. We'll get into the bankruptcy remoteness of the SPV and the non-consolidation opinion that law firms typically provide. As I mentioned a slide or two ago, there often is a request, obviously, from the lender to have a guarantee from the fund. That does present issues in terms of whether that fund balance sheet is available to satisfy the requirements of one SPV versus another, or if all the SPVs are going to be backed by that guarantee. That sort of it stresses the analysis a little bit in terms of these isolated financings for each particular part of the portfolio. All right. As I mentioned, the fund, at the fund level, the fund can identify certain assets, place those assets in the SPV, but those assets then is not necessarily static, especially when we're talking about private credit. And as Michael said earlier in their webinar, some of these assets, you know, they're tradable assets. They can move in and out of the portfolio. So we will often have portfolio eligibility criteria that allows for the manager of the fund to manage the portfolio as the manager was doing prior to the financing. And so the portfolio criteria that Michael and Shiraz will get into later will basically set out a matrix. And so an asset can be removed from the portfolio as long as it's replaced with cash or it's replaced with another asset that fits within those criteria. This example on this next slide is basically what I was talking about. A loan in the portfolio will have to meet criteria specific to that loan, and then once that loan is added to the portfolio, that portfolio with the new loan or other asset will have to satisfy the overall criteria. And again, the idea here is the lender is comfortable with a certain portfolio that's presented to it when the lender goes to its credit committee. We just need to ensure that portfolio looks something similar to, or you know, substantially similar to the portfolio that was approved by the lender at the outset of the transaction.
I think asset substitutions are fine, but the way you originally approach this is you have a snapshot at a point in time. And again, a true private equity fund versus infrastructure versus credit versus real estate, there's some nuances to each one of these. But the snapshot usually is when the borrower, being the GP, comes to the lender with kind of this X portfolio and wants to get certain types of leverage against it. So you have a shot at a point in time. Substitutions are fine, subject that the lender's not worse off. Obviously, some collateral may have been sold away, a new collateral was added. So if you look at the asset types, for example, if you look at a portfolio company and you look at the total leverage of that, you know, what turn of leverage are you going to be effectively if you are the ABL lender at the top of this house? You know, are you over leveraging the portfolio, or, you know, does it make sense? Will the dividends cover, et cetera? So it's all kind of in consideration. Where are you? What's your security package, et cetera? You know, there are also some comments around minimum asset size or also maximum, you know, are certain assets skewing the portfolio? So do I have a diversified portfolio, or do I really have two or three assets in this ABL facility? Minimum ratings, many things aren't rated, frankly, but if you can get ratings from some of the deals, obviously that makes sense. Currency exposures, some people have obviously multi-currency portfolios. Some lenders are okay with that, some are not. That also brings up the question of hedging. Tranche size, again, bids, and we'll get into valuation as well. But quickly speaking, if you look at debt funds, I was primarily speaking about kind of real asset owning funds, but if you look at debt funds, you have a similar thing where, you know, again, total LTV at the loan, if you're leveraging a loan portfolio, advance rates, things of that nature, they all kind of come into play, and they'll be set up with a matrix during the underwriting process that would be part of the documents for the borrower to understand. And again, I was alluding to a second ago, but again, maximum single company concentration issues, total debt leverage issues, geographic issues come into play as well, especially as funds are maybe not just investing in the U.S., they're investing abroad. There may be some countries that don't work. Again, standard assets versus non-standard assets, in a sense where some funds may be quote-unquote private equity, but start buying some rights or others. Can you put that again, options? Can you put that in the facility? Not necessarily. But the lender's also looking at kind of the weighted average rating factors in the sense of, you know, how do we get capital treatment on the loan that we're effectively giving to the borrower. So all this comes into play, but that's the point I'm trying to make essentially, is that there's a lot of criteria that goes into rating a NAV facility, so to speak, for any type of fund, and each deal is very bespoke and unique to itself.
Yeah, I would just add that we're structuring an asset-based line right now, and we do have a catch-all bucket to basically non-standard asset limit, and I think it's 15 or 20% of the portfolio, so it's a rather large bucket. To the extent that an asset or a number of assets exceed that 10, 15, 20% limit, that's obviously cut out of the borrowing base. That's basically how it works. It's not as if we can't put the asset into the collateral pool. It's just that portion of the portfolio above the limit on the catch-all bucket, that just won't go into the borrowing base.
One of the big questions really is valuation. Obviously, again, running the gamut of the types of assets we're talking about, the types of fund managers, valuation in terms of as you all know, many people do it as a DCF with some sort of kind of third-party review, either quarterly, semi-annual, or annually, but there is some concept around, you know, we want some comfort around who's valuing the assets, how they're being valued, and obviously doing our own marks as well. There are assets, to Matt's comment, that don't necessarily fit. So there are some comments around bank debt, tradable assets, structured products, CMBS, RMBS, et cetera, that come into a lending fund specifically as, you know, an opportunistic buy. The question is, can it really be submitted as collateral? If not, then it's not to the borrowing base, but it's boot collateral for the lender, really. Things like art and wine, we've seen people try to pledge that actually some esoteric kind of special situations funds. It creates an interesting challenge, but don't normally advance against it, but there are some that do. We talked about earlier the haircuts, advance rates, that happens usually at the outset, and then there's some sort of look back in terms of if there's market events, et cetera. Like we already covered the hedging and derivatives.
Okay. Yeah, we see private banks doing loans backed by art to some of their high net worth clients. So just a couple last couple points. I think we have a number of questions, and we will not be able to get to all these questions, but I just want to mention a couple things on the structure. On the SPV, the idea is that the SPV is ring-fenced from the fund, the parent fund, and if the SPV were to go down, even though the SPV should not have any other business activities, it's possible, obviously, if the portfolio does not perform, that the SPV could suffer in terms of credit worthiness. The SPV will have separateness covenants. The SPV's counsel will provide a non-consolidation opinion. And in the event of insolvency of the funds, the SPV and its portfolio would still be available to the lender. The only other thing I want to mention, just because this is coming up more and more frequently, especially with funds that just have issues with cash flows because of their illiquid portfolios, some of the structures we see are cash flow structures. So the cash flows that come off of the loan portfolio basically are used to determine whether the collateralization tests are met or not. And if the collateralization test is not met, there's a trapping mechanism for additional cash flows that were not originally leaned up. There might be additional cash flows that are not part of the structure at all, such as fees that go to the manager. Those cash flows then can be trapped and diverted to the lender if necessary. Alternatively, we've seen a number of structures where the collateral is viewed not on a cash flow basis, but on a mark-to-market basis, and there will be a periodic mark of the portfolio, and if the LTV is breached as a result of a mark, then instead of looking to cash flows or trapping cash flows, there will be actually a margin call made to the fund. And that often is more problematic because the fund, unless maybe it has a subline, may not have the cash available to meet that margin call. So I did want to touch on that because those are some of the critical issues we've been dealing with mark-to-market structures. We have a couple of minutes left. Do you want to answer any of these questions?
I mean, sure. You want to talk about the first
one? Yeah, the first question was, how can a newly launched fund actually get a subline if it doesn't have any assets? That's actually one of the benefits of a subline. As long as you have a roster of LPs that a bank is willing to lend against, it's actually going to be that you don't have to have any assets, right? The assets for the line are those LP contractual capital commitment. So that's what we actually typically see for new funds is effectively a blind pool at that point, but it also doesn't matter because the collateral for the bank is the LP commitment.
Yeah, I mean, I would say we worked on actually worked with you, Matt. We worked on one recently where the GP had a traditional business and they were starting a new fund structure. They didn't have the LPs necessarily lined up at first. We had a ballpark idea of who they were going to be, and then we went kind of from there as the process firmed up and they had the LPA done, et cetera. But, yeah, that's not really an unusual comment. It's kind of, you start drafting in docs, you have an idea of who your LPs are going to be, institution, non-institution, et cetera, and then we can go from that point.
Another question is, do the investors of the LP seek restrictions in the subline with respect to the ability of the general partner rather than the lender to call capital? Now, this obviously would only occur in the event of a default. And I would say a lender is not really going to give up that ability to allow the GP to call collateral. I have seen a number of sublines that say, in the event of a default, the general partner will call the collateral. But as a practical matter, I think the lender is going to mandate that if the GP does not act within X number of days, that the lender will basically step into the shoes of the general partner. The question is, are there any workarounds of that? I don't think there are any. The lender ultimately has to have that ability to call the collateral.
I've never seen any. I mean, in our case as well.
Yeah. That would be tough. There are many other questions. We'll, after this webinar in the next days to come, we'll reach out to those with the questions and we'll help you work through those. But at this point, I think we'll turn it back over to the webinar organizer.
Thank you. Thank you again for joining us for today's call.